Good morning.
Good morning.
Our processional hymn is number 319.
Thank you.
Spirit to be the life and light of your church. Open our hearts to the riches of your grace, that we may bring forth the fruit of the Spirit in love, joy, and peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please sit for the reading.
A reading from the book of Genesis. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, O Lord God, what will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is the Eliezer of Damascus. And Abram said, You have given me no offspring, and so a slave born in my house is to be my heir. But the word of the Lord came to him, This man shall not be your heir, no one but your very own issue shall be your heir. He brought him outside and said, Look toward heaven and count the stars, if you are able to count them. Then he said to him, So shall your descendants be. And he believed the Lord, and the Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let's say the song together in unison. Happy is the nation
whose God is the Lord,
the people he has chosen as his heritage.
The Lord looks
down from heaven.
He sees all humankind.
From where he sits enthroned, he watches all the inhabitants of the earth.
He who fashions the hearts of them all
and observes all their deeds. A king is not saved by his great army.
A warrior is not delivered by his great strength.
The war horse is a vain hope for victory, and by its great might it cannot save. Truly the eye of the Lord is on those who fear him, on those who hope in his steadfast love, to deliver their soul from death and to keep them alive. Our soul waits for the Lord. He is our help and shield. Our heart is glad in him because we trust in his holy name. Let your steadfast love, O Lord, be upon us, even as we hope in you.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Indeed, by faith, our ancestors received approval. By faith, we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God, so that what is seen was made from things that are not visible. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to set out for a place that he was to receive as an inheritance. And he set out, not knowing where he was going. By faith he stayed for a time in the land he had been promised, as in a foreign land, living in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked forward to the city that has foundations, whose architect and builder is God. By faith he received power of procreation, even though he was too old, and Sarah herself was barren. Because he considered himself faithful who had promised. Therefore, for one person, and this one as good as dead, descendants were born, as many as the stars of heaven, and as the innumerable grains of sand by the seashore. All of these died in faith without having received the promises, but from a distance they saw and greeted them. They confessed that they were strangers and foreigners on the earth. For people who speak in this way make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. If they had been thinking of the land that they had left behind and would have had opportunity to return, But as it is, they desire a better country, that is, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God. Indeed, he has prepared a city for them. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. And it is inevitable that on the morning we are about to depart for some trip somewhere in Trinidad, that his father disappears. Just at the penultimate moment, he disappears. We're all ready to go, and he's missing in action. And he usually reappears, I would say, a good hour later. And he has always gone off on the same task. And you'd think we would all know it by now and simply recognize it. He goes to the closest garage, or livery, as they call it there. He gets his tire pressure checked, gets his oil checked, checks all the fluid levels, makes sure everything is fine. And then he comes home and tells us exactly how much luggage, including our own weight, we may put in the car, because he's faithful to his auto manual, which tells him exactly how much weight his tire pressure can bear. We always laugh at him and we think that he's old-fashioned and he's, you know, overthinking and over-planning. But the fact is, he has now done everything necessary within his power to make certain that the trip will be safe. He has faith that those who have serviced his car have done it correctly, that he has done all he can in his part, and that the rest is up to God. And so really, what we need to remember, what we need to add to the letter to the Hebrews, lengthy instruction to us about what faith is about, is what faith is not about. Faith is not about wish fulfillment. Faith is about long-term plan. Faith is not about wish fulfillment. It's not about wishing a thing would happen and then standing back and hoping that it does. Our evidence for that is every single interaction God has with his people, either in the Old Testament at the beginning, in Genesis, or right to the end of the New Testament. God acts in partnership with those people who put their faith in him. He acts in partnership with us when we do our part and do everything we can to then make our desires come true. Who of us prays that we will do well in an exam and then never attends the course or studies? Who then wishes we could be a doctor, but just choose medical school and just tacks the DR onto our name? Who of us desires or hopes that we'll get a wonderful job if we never train or study or prepare ourselves? Who of us hopes that the world will be a better place, that climate change will be halted, yet continues to drive large cars when we can walk to where we're going, using items that will never ever degrade, continually overusing things we don't really need? Who of us hopes for healthy lifestyles if we smoke, drink to excess, don't watch our diet, our exercise, see a physician regularly, watch our weight, our mental and physical health? If we look at God's interaction with his world from Genesis to the end, we can whittle it down to a fairly easy observation. In the beginning, God created the world. And when he had finished creating, what did he see? He saw that it was
good.
Good. He saw that it was pretty good. Because he did it. So he made the world and all that is in it. And he rested because he saw that it was good. And then humanity decided to get involved. And if we look at the story, creation, the development of humanity, and the history as the Bible shows us, we see that the rest of God's interactions is God seeing the appalling mess we have not about wish fulfillment. It's about long-term planning. When Jesus says to his disciples today, do not be afraid, he ends that story by saying what? Watch, be prepared, because you do not know the hour the Son of Man is coming. When God speaks to Abram in Genesis today, what does he say to him? Do not be afraid. Why? Because I have a plan. Now the fly in that ointment was Abram himself, because he didn't really believe that God had a plan. So Abram thought he would help God along and be inventive with God's plan. He didn't listen to God. He was unwilling to surrender his will to God's plan for him. And so throughout the first part of Genesis, we have the lengthy story of Abraham's inability to sit back and allow God to work it out. God asked for one thing from Abraham. It was cooperation. Abraham, come. Look outside. What do you see? Stars. Right now you have no children. I guarantee you, you will be able to count your descendants. Abraham believed it, but then he didn't act on his belief. If we say we have faith, we have to know that God's plan for us is a long-term initiative. As Hebrews says, faith is hoping for things we know we need and want, and understanding that their fulfillment might be farther down the road. Abraham didn't see his descendants multiplied to those numbers, but he did see a son. If we think of the people that Jesus interacted with, if we think of the miracles he performed, they weren't magic. If we think of any of the miracles, they involved human contribution to God's plan. Even something as large as the feeding of the 5,000. Jesus didn't feed from nothing. Where did that food come from? A boy with of
loaves
and fishes. Jesus didn't conjure it up out of nowhere. He called forth generosity, he called forth faith, and he called forth the desire of humanity to cooperate in a divine plan. Faith is not about wish fulfillment. It's about cooperating with God's long-term plan. If we hope to see the end of violence and racism in our world, we can't just hope and wish that someone else will make it so. We have to look at our own actions, listen to our own words, be guardians of our own thoughts, and ask ourselves, how far am I cooperating in my desire to see God right these things? If we want to save a planet for our children and grandchildren, we can't stand back and wish as we're driving our car, throwing our litter out the window, using up more of the world's resources than we truly need. Unless we're willing to attune our behavior with God's creative desire in the beginning, our faith is destined to be disappointed. Hebrews reminds us today that we are not living here permanently. The wishes we have for this life should be negligible at best, because we aren't residents of this place. We seek another country. We look for another kingdom. We pray daily that God's kingdom will come. So all our attitudes, all our desires, all our actions, all our hopes, all our wishes, all our energies should be directed not to the things of this world, but to enter into the desires that God has for us. And he desires us to return to him, to live with him in another city, another kingdom, another country. We're strangers here, we're foreigners here, Hebrews tells us, because we're destined for another place. So our faith, our prayers, our hopes, our wishes, our actions, our desires should point away from what we think we need now and more towards that other kingdom. The kingdom where we will truly be at home. Because we have a choice. Like everything else with God, we have a choice. We can choose this life, pursue it to its end, enjoy it to the risk and loss of others, or we can look ahead to that other kingdom, to a place where we want to dwell with all our brothers and sisters of the faith who have gone before us, to live in the place where we were meant to be, where we will live our fullest lives, that other country, that other kingdom, that other place, a place where we don't worry about what we eat, what we wear, what kind of car we'll drive, what kind of house we can take care of, but rather those things where laws cannot destroy, those things thieves cannot take away from us, eternal life with Jesus Christ. Our response to God's presence with us in his word is that our confession of faith, in the words of the Apostles' Creed on page 189. Let us confess the faith of our baptism as we say,
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins,
the prayers of the people can be found on page 112, number 2. Let us pray with confidence to the Lord, saying, Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
O Lord, guard and direct the church in the way of unity, service, and praise.
Lord, hear our prayer.
In the worldwide Anglican Communion, we pray for the people and clergy of the United Church of South India, Archbishop Thomas Janpalli, Omini, moderator. In the Diocese of Toronto, we remember the people and clergy of the Anglican Deanery. And for our own parish family members, please pray this week for Mark, Aaron, Christian Hawk, and Tracy Armstrong, Diane and Kirk Herter, Todd Hillhouse, and Chris Mackey. For our brothers and sisters at St. Mark's and Trillium United. In the world, we remember Michael Spavor and Michael Kunu. And for our Muslim brothers and sisters participating in the Hajj. Give to all nations an awareness of the unity of the human family.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Cleanse our hearts of prejudice and selfishness, and inspire us to hunger and thirst for what is right.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Teach us to use your creation for your greater praise, that all may share the good things you provide.
Lord, hear our prayers.
We remember the sick and suffering. David, Bill, Hillary, Joan, the Reverend Sheila Ashworth, the Reverend John Anderson, Bishop Peter Fenty, Robert Cox, Aaron, David McMullen, Pete, Rick, Rita Vine, Logan McCaughey, Nanette Seaman, and any others known to you, aloud or in your heart.
Lucy.
Strengthen all who give their energy or skill for the healing of those who are sick in body or in mind.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Set free all who are bound by fear and despair.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Please remember Archdeacon Lord Feeney, remembering Adele, his wife, and the family. Grant a peaceful end and eternal rest to all who are dying, and your comfort to those who have mourned.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Gracious God, you have heard the people, the prayers of your faithful people. You know our need before we ask and our ignorance in asking. Grant your requests as may be best for us. This we ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Continue on page 191. Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites us to his table. Let us confess our sins confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God,
we confess we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may be glad in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and forgive you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ said to his disciples, my peace I leave to you, my peace I leave with you. Not as the world gives, give I unto you. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us greet one another in the peace of Christ.
Thank you.
seem wholly off you this day, and grant that in this Eucharist we may be enriched by the gifts of the Spirit. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Our Eucharistic prayer is prayer 2 on page 196. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift
up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
We give you thanks and praise, Almighty God, through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Redeemer. He is your living Word, through whom you have created all things. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh of the Virgin Mary and shared our human nature. He lived and died as one of us to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. In fulfillment of your will, he stretched out his hands in suffering to bring release to those who placed their hope in you. And so he won for you a holy people. He chose to bear our griefs and sorrows and to give up his life on the cross, that he might shatter the chains of evil and death and banish the darkness of sin and despair. By his resurrection, he brings us into the light of your presence. Now with all creation, we raise our voices to proclaim the glory of your name. Remembering therefore his death and resurrection, we offer you this bread and this cup, giving thanks that you have made us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. We ask you to send your Holy Spirit upon the offering of your holy church, gathering to one all who share in these sacred mysteries, filling them with the Holy Spirit and confirming their faith in the truth, that together we may praise you and give you glory through your servant Jesus Christ. All glory and honor are yours, Father and Son, with the Holy Spirit, in the Holy Church, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray, Our Father in heaven,
hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Amen.
Our sentence for the fraction is sentence number 2. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
We eat and eat our own body. For we all share in one bread.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are they who are called to his supper, the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Lamb of God.
wine and the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Yourself, or if you know someone who might like to have a coffee, please take them. church wardens and advisory board meeting on the 27th of August. And a little further into the future is our parish cornrows on the 6th of September. Are there any other announcements not contained in the bulletin which need to be made? Please join your brothers and sisters in the hall next door for some tea, coffee, and other refreshments, and maybe make the acquaintance of someone you haven't spoken to before. Have a safe and blessed week.
Rejoicing in the power of the Spirit.
Thanks be to God.